Good morning, Office Gate. Amen. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Once again. Amen. I'm so glad y'all are here. Those of you who are watching the live, welcome this morning to our services. So at some point, y'all are going to not only quiet down, but y'all going to sit down. So, All right, this morning I am reading Psalms 62, reading from the New Living Translation. It's a song of David. It's written to one of his musicians. I think that this young man's whole family was a bunch of singers. His name is Jaduthan. So I'm going to Psalm 62, New Living Translation. And the beautiful song, I'll start with verses 5. I'm going to read through the end, through 12. Psalm 62, New Living Translation, verses 5 through 12. Let all that I am wait quietly before the Lord, for my hope is in Him. He alone is my rock and my salvation, my fortress, where I will not be shaken. My victory and honor come from God alone. He is my refuge, a rock where no enemy can reach me. Oh, my people, trust in Him at all times. Pour out your heart to Him, for God is our refuge. Shalom. Common people are as worthless as a puff of wind, and the powerful are not what they appear to be. If you weigh them on scales, together they are lighter than a breath of air. Don't make your living by extortion or put your hope in stealing. And if your wealth increases, don't make it the center of your life. God has spoken plainly, and I've heard it many times. Power, O God, belongs to you. Unfailing love, O Lord, is yours. Surely you repay all people according to what they have done. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for your mercy and for your grace. And Lord, power, even in this world, even in right now, 2024, power belongs to you. So, Father, help us to get that strength this morning. Lord, we invite you to come in. We invite your Holy Spirit to come in and have its way. Oh, God, we thank you for your presence, for your love, for your support. Father, you are our refuge, not our children, not our checkbook, not our spouse. You are our refuge. So, Father, it's in you, Lord, that we trust. And so, God, I thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do today. It's all about you. I thank you for what you're doing in our lives. Father, you are welcome in this place. In the name of Jesus, we pray, O Lord. Amen.
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart made up but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. Just one word, you hear what's broken inside me. Just one word, and you revive every dream. One touch, I feel the power of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart will never believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Well, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall we can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, great and mighty God,
And thank you, Lord. We celebrate your promises to us, your promise of life eternal, your promise of health and healing, your promises of taking care of us and our families, God. Your promises of restoration, God. Your promises of deliverance. We thank you, God, for those promises. This morning, Lord, this morning we choose to stand on those promises, Lord Jesus.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Savior as my all in all. What is all? What is all? shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, rest in his righteousness alone, all blessed to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking
from the Lord, from the Holy Spirit, so that we can apply that to our lives. say, well, they're, you know, here and not there, and they ought to be over here. See? And so but Wesley comes along and he said, now wait a minute. There's not just either or things in the scripture. There are also both and. The scripture teaches that you and I have, right now, we are seated with Christ in the heavenly places. That is a truth. That is the truth of the Word of God. But guess what? You're also seated in the chair that you're sitting in right now. See, it's both and. There's a part of me, and really, if I look at and understand a little bit of the righteousness of God in my life, I am completely righteous. In my spirit man, my spirit man does not know how to sin. So I can declare to you today I am sinless. But those of you who know me will say, now wait a minute. Pastor, it's a little bit of both and on that one. You see, we've seen you now for almost 8 years now. Can you believe we've been here 8 years? I don't believe it. This is the stuff of science fiction. I mean, it's just beyond me to think that we've passed this much time with you already, and I trust that over the years we've all changed, and we are all changing. We are all becoming, but we have to live with tension, truths that are intention, opposites that are intention. You know, there's a whole lot to be said for that. And part of our struggle is that we stride between the here and now and the sweet by and by. We struggle between the present and the past. And we drag that stuff that's been in our past and we drag it into our present. And some of us have the uncanny knack and ability to drag that stuff from the past and throw it into the future before we've even lived it. And we borrow grief from the future in anticipation that, well, it'll always be the way it's always going to be. That's just the way it's always been. And what happened back here is going to follow me over here into the future, and I'll never get beyond that. I'll never get past that. And we live in defeat, not understanding that it's both and. We don't want to forget what we've been through. The psalmist said, I remember the day that I was in the miry pit. Yeah. The clay, I remember when I was down in there. And I was streaked. I mean, I'm reading in the Psalms right now, and that's the biggest bunch of whiners I've ever seen. And it's good for our soul. It's one pastor friend of mine says that it's the medicine chest of the soul.
Right.
Because we could cry out with the psalmist and say, oh God, why have you forsaken me?
Right.
Oh God, why have you forgotten me?
Right.
God, when are you going to take care of my enemies? When are you going to get so-and-so off of my back? God, when are you going to come and rule and reign in righteousness? God, I'm tired. I cry in my bed all night long. I soak my pillow with my tears. And we need that. We need to cry to the Lord. And the Lord has broad shoulders. He can take whatever you want to tell Him. If you're happy today, tell Him you're happy. If you're sad today, tell Him you're sad. If you're angry, tell Him you're angry. It won't be anything that He hasn't heard before. Thank God I finally got out of Job. Good night. His three friends, some of the things they said, good night. With friends like that. Golly. And then of all things, when the thing just starts ending up in the book of Job, the Lord finally opens His mouth and He takes them on a National Geographic tour of the universe. intention. And there is, now, so that I'm not misunderstood, I'm going to use the word dissatisfaction this morning, and I don't want you to misunderstand me. There is a holy dissatisfaction that we can experience. I can love Jesus more. I can be more filled with the Spirit. I can live for Christ more every moment of every day. And I'm wholly dissatisfied when I don't do that, when I fail to do that. But then there's an unholy dissatisfaction where nothing is ever good enough. Nothing is ever good enough. Well, if I can just get that raise and make more money, it'll be better. And you make more money and go out and buy a big old car and try and figure out why in the world you have less money than you had before you got the raise. There is an unholy dissatisfaction. If you'll remember Eve in the garden, I mean, she had it all. She had the whole thing. I mean, some of us dream of what life could be in the garden. How wonderful, just walk around and just eat the fruit and talk to the animals and go for a swim and just do whatever we want to do. And then she gets into a conversation with the enemy of our souls. And all of a sudden, she's dissatisfied with what she had. There is an unholy dissatisfaction. So many of us live in that world. So many of us live in a world that absolutely nothing going on in our life is able to bring satisfaction to us. Our marriages are dissatisfactory. Our jobs are dissatisfactory. Our friendships are dissatisfactory. Our health is to be something that we're dissatisfied with. And we blame it on the doctor. Well, if I had a better doctor that give me better medicine, I'd have better health. Well, no, if you put down the Krispy Kremes and the ice cream down here for Brahms, or not Brahms, what's the name of that place down here? Thank you, Bluebell. You know what part of Texas I was from? We had Brahms when I was up there. Brahms is good. We want to blame everybody else and everything else in our life, and we're dissatisfied, and it's unholy. There are unholy expectations that we put on each other. There are unholy expectations that we put on our church. Boy, unless the Holy Spirit does this away at this time, I'm going to leave here dissatisfied with the way things are. Check yourself. Is that a holy dissatisfaction? Because you want more of God? And you want God to move? Or is it an unholy expectation that you're putting on everybody else? Well, discontent versus contentment. We went round and round the block yesterday with the men's ministry. All we managed to do was divide between 51% and 49% on the issue that we were talking about. Is it this away or is it that away? And we had an either or conversation. It was an either-or conversation, and we drew the line and said, everybody that thinks this, let's see your hand. Everybody that thinks this, let's see that hand. I didn't vote. Because I wasn't given the option. If it's both, would you raise your hand? I'd have gone like that. There are both and situations in life. It's not just one way. The very first sin that we encounter is that it's not enough. It's just never enough. But look at what Jesus has said in this story of the woman at the well. Let's stand as we read the Word of God. I'm going to start in verse 5. I'm going to start in verse 5. I'm going to read through 30. And then we're going to skip to verse 39. tired of standing, you're welcome to sit. But it's okay. It'll be over in just a second. So he, Jesus, came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being weary from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have well said, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." "You think? Our fathers worshiped on this mountain, and you Jews say that the Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." At this point, his disciples came and they marveled that he talked with a woman, yet no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why are you talking to her?" The woman left her water pot, went her way into the city, and said to the men, "Come see a man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" Then they went out of the city and came to him. Now verse 39 through 42. And many of the Samaritans of that city believed in him because of the word of the woman who testified, "He told me all that I ever did." So when the Samaritans had come to him, they urged him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days, and many more believed because of his own word. Then they said to the woman, "Now we believe, not because of what you said, for we ourselves have heard him, and we know that this is indeed the Christ, the Savior of the world." Now John 7, 37 through 39. And on the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried out, saying, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water." By this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Be seated, please. The woman showed up in the sixth hour. Now that's not 6 a.m. The Jews, the first hour for them is 6 a.m. All right? to notice two things about what Jesus said in these verses 13 and 14. He says, he said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. I want you to notice, first of all, that this offer for this water is for everyone. It's for everyone. It's for every one of us here this morning. We have an opportunity to receive from Christ the living water and be satiated, to be satisfied, to find our lives not one series of discontentedness all throughout the hours, but we can find ourselves living this life in a satisfied, meaningful, purposeful way. Boy, if you lose your purpose and you lose your joie de vivre, you know the joie de vivre, you know the joy of life, as the French would say, followed by a ha-ha. You lose that joie de vivre and it just saps the energy out of you. I want us to understand that this offer is to everyone living. And if you want to understand this, look at this conversation between Jesus and this woman. The offer is to everyone regardless of sex. Now, it doesn't matter to Jesus that he was talking to a woman. You understand that culturally speaking, that was a taboo. You don't do that. Men are men, and they live in that world, and they converse with one another, but they don't talk to women. They might talk to their wives and their daughters, but in that culture, at that time, women were not in the same category of men to have conversations with. Lamentable, but true. I think women ought to be glad that at least the women sitting in this room ought to be glad that their voices are recognized and their voices are heard and they are, that their opinion matters and what they say matters. This is a silly thing, but my wife just yesterday explained to me after 46 years of marriage why I'm supposed to draw the curtain after I shower. I thought I was doing good, bunching it over to the side and extending that towel and letting that towel dry, air dry. And she had to come in and say, now, honey, let me show you why this is important. To draw this curtain, because all that moisture will gather up in the corner over here and that shower curtain will mildew. And if you go ahead and, you know, close it, then it'll air dry as well. So this morning, honey, I did that. It took me 46 years, but I finally, there's hope. There was also the fact that Jesus has this offer to everyone regardless of their sex, but also regardless of their ethnicity. She was from Samaria. That's another thing. She was from the wrong side of town. She was from across the tracks. The Samaritans were not looked upon well by the Jews. That's why she was saying, what are you doing? You being a Jew talking to me, a Samaritan? Crazy. First of all, I'm a woman. You figure that out. That's a taboo. I can't believe you're talking to me. Second of all, I'm a Samaritan woman. I can't believe that either. And Jesus makes this offer to her, and it says to everyone and whoever, despite prejudice. To Jesus is prejudice. He's not prejudiced. We're the ones that struggle with prejudice. I'll never forget when I first started my journey 20-something years ago, or nearly 20 years about yourself. Tell me what kind of church you'd like to pastor. And I said, well, I would love to pastor a church that looks like heaven. And he stared at me. He goes, what do you mean? I said, well, I read my Bible, and in the book of the Revelation, it says that around the throne of God, there were thousands upon thousands worshiping from every tribe, every nation, every tongue, every ethnicity was there worshiping the Lord. And there was Chinese people there. Believe it or not, Chinese people can be Christians. Mexicans can be Christians. I just can't believe it. People in Finland can be Christians? People in India are Christians? You know, we have this American idea. Well, I don't want to get lost on that, but despite our prejudices, regardless of our prejudices, Jesus extends the offer to everyone. Well, he told me, when I told him I wanted to pastor a church like that, he said, I don't know of any. Apparently, he didn't know about Aldersgate. Despite parentage, the offer is to anyone, no matter who your parents were or who your parents, you don't even know who they were. You know that every one of us have been adopted by God? Oh, there's a powerful lesson to understand in adoption. All the rights and privileges and authority that is resident within the father and the mother are passed on to the child. It doesn't matter if they're blood or not. And if you're struggling with not knowing who your parents are, let me encourage you. You know who your heavenly father is. That's a good daddy to have. He's a good God. He's a good daddy. The offer is to everyone despite their sex, their ethnicity, the prejudice that they have, their parentage and their family history, despite their marital status. This woman, who knows why she had five husbands? I don't know. You know, back in that day, the husband had to divorce the wife. So maybe the first she married, husband number one, and it just wasn't working out for him. Here's your paper, honey, hit the bricks. So she went on to husband number two. The same kind of thing. We don't know why she had five husbands. When we get to heaven, maybe you can find her. You can sit down and say, what happened, darling? What happened? But things back then, a woman needed to attach herself to a man just to survive. They would have no resource outside of that relationship. And so despite her marital status, Jesus said, listen, if you drink the water I'll give you, you'll never thirst again. Doesn't matter if you've had five husbands. Doesn't matter if the one you're living with now, you're shacking up with it. It's because whatever has happened, there was a dissatisfaction along the way. Something wasn't working out. But listen, if you drink the water I give you, you'll be satisfied. And he made an offer to her despite her worshiping tradition. The worship tradition. Well, us Samaritans think we worship over here. Y'all Jews think we worship over here. And it's between this mountain and that mountain. It's either or, right? Either or. No! Jesus said no. You got to understand something. There's coming a day where those mountains won't matter. All that will matter is that you worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Amen. You worship Him by the Spirit and truth. Well, not only is the offer to everyone living, but also the offer is eternal life. That's a good deal, guys. That's a real good deal. Eternal life. Now, I defined this for you last time, and let's see. I won't put anybody on the spot by having you stand up and give me the definition of Ionios Zoe. Except, Grace, I could probably ask you to do that. You'd be fine. Eternal life, everlasting. you trust Jesus Christ, when the Holy Spirit of God breathes in you the breath of life and you're reborn and you're born of the Spirit from above, you receive the Holy Spirit to regenerate you and you're made alive in Christ. In that moment, He deposits in you the gift of eternal life. You had it when you were born again. And you can start to live a supernatural quality of life. You don't have to be stuck on this side of the island in the natural world. You can actually experience the supernatural world. The world of miracles and healing and manifestations and demonstrations of the power of God in your life. We can do that. It's the offer is for eternal life and supernatural. But now I want us to skip over to John 7. And I want you to notice there in John 7 what Jesus says to everybody that's there. He stood up, he cried out to everybody, if anyone thirsts, anybody, let him come to church. If anyone thirsts, if anyone's dissatisfied with the way things are, let him go to the voting booth. If anyone thirsts, let him go to the Bahamas and drink mojitos. And then you'll be happy. Don't worry. Be happy. No, Jesus said, if anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. He spoke of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit resident within the life of the believer that will become to us a fountain of power, a fountain of satisfaction. He said, you know, back there he told that woman something. And I don't understand this. Told her, if you drink this water, you'll never thirst again. Never thirst again. Yet how many of us in our Christian experience, we have tasted of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit has come upon our life, and yet we find ourselves being the most dissatisfied people on the planet. Never happy with anything that we got. Never satisfied with what God is doing in our life or the way He's doing it. Well, let me ask you this. Is Jesus a liar?
No.
He said, if you tasted this and you have this water, this Holy Spirit water, it'll maybe be a fountain to you. It'll be a fountain to you, and you'll never thirst again. That means, Joseph, if I have it all and I want to keep it all, I'm satisfied. That means, Adrian, if I want to give it all away and have nothing, I'm satisfied. If I'm healed, glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm healed. The hip pain is gone. The back pain is gone. The headaches are gone. The cancer is gone. Hallelujah. But if it's not, I'm satisfied with Jesus. Amen. Jesus is enough. I'll never forget being a whiny psalmist myself one day. Whining to the Lord. Ah, Lord, if I could just make this happen, if this would just work in my favor, if I could just get that break, Lord, I tell you, I'd be so happy, I'd be so satisfied. And the Lord just took the air right out of the room when He asked me, son, am I not enough? Am I not enough? I tell you, I wept. Because I know that he's enough. He's enough. I want to read for you something that I didn't know about this guy. This old boy was from Louisiana. I thought, can anything good come out of Louisiana? I say that because my kids live in Louisiana. I'm just joking. I'm messing with everybody in here. I'm messing with you. I love Louisiana. I love my kids. I'd love to go to Louisiana. Oh, there's some good Louisiana food, let me tell you. This hymn writer is named B.B. McKinney, and he was from Louisiana. And he wrote these words: I am satisfied with Jesus. He has done so much for me. He has suffered to redeem me. He has died to set me free. He is with me in my trials. Best of friends of all is he. I can always count on Jesus. Can he always count on me? I'm satisfied. I'm satisfied. I'm satisfied with Jesus. But the question comes to me as I think of Calvary, is my Jesus satisfied with me? I can hear the voice of Jesus calling out so pleadingly, go and win the lost and straying. Is he satisfied with me? When my work on earth is ended and I cross the mystic sea, oh, that I could hear him saying, I am satisfied with thee. I am satisfied. I am satisfied. I'm satisfied with Jesus. But the question comes to me as I think of Calvary, is my Jesus satisfied with me? I told the Lord in that room, I said, Lord, you're enough. You're enough. You're more than enough. If I just had my wife and my children, that's more than enough. If we lived under a bridge somewhere and ate beetles and grass and drank out of, McDonald's water fountain, that'd be enough. That would be enough. More than enough. But Lord, if you want to let me live in Castlegate, hallelujah. I think that's a neighborhood. I don't know. I'll just say Highland Park. That's Highland Park up in Dallas. That's where all the big wigs live. Mark Cuban in that bunk. Whatever the Lord wants to bless me with, that's what I want. Because whether I have any of that stuff or not, I'm satisfied with Jesus. I don't ever want to thirst again. And now, I want to help you with something. Why is it that we think it's either or? Why do we think, well, Jesus said, if I take of this water, I will never thirst again, but yet I do. I'll tell you why. And it's on because of one word. One word. Said, but the water that I shall give him will become. That word become indicates process. Process. You and I are all in process. We are all moving along a continuum. And I hope you're making progress. And sometimes it's one step forward and three steps back. But then there's one step forward and maybe a second step forward and maybe five steps back. We're all in process. Today I'm satisfied in Jesus. Hallelujah. Today I'm with the psalmist and I'm down in the dumps and I'm whining and I'm crying and I'm saying, why me, Lord, how long? Because we're in process. You see, the Holy Spirit of God wants to not only just dwell within us, but it wants to so permeate and so saturate every part of our lives that every part of our lives is messed up. He wants to mess us up, and you and I want everything status quo. Well, Lord, I'll let you have this little part of my life, and you can mess that up. That's fine. up on Sunday between 10:30 and noon. But at 12:01, I'm the boss again, and I'm going to do it the way I want to do it. And I'm going to call it the way I see it. And I'm going to live however I want to live. And Lord, I'll see you next week. No, that is not becoming, allowing the Holy Spirit to become in you a water fountain. And in fact, if Jesus said, he spoke with the Spirit, and he says, he who believes in me, as the scripture said, out of his heart will flow rivers of living water. Not just a fountain, but a river. Did y'all ever do that one? I got a river of life flowing out of me. Makes the lame to walk and the blind to see. Opens prison doors, sets the captives free. I got a river of life flowing out of me. Bring up a well. Amen. Y'all knew that one, all right. Jesus said, if you'll do three things, if you'll come to me, if you'll believe in me, and if you'll receive the Spirit. Some of us have come to Jesus. Some of us have believed on Jesus. But some of us have not ever allowed the Holy Spirit to come in and just wipe us out. And totally saturate us. And fill every inch and every pore of our lives. We're still hanging on to what we want to hang on to. The Holy Spirit wants to be the one who becomes in us everything that we need so that he satisfies us. I'm so satisfied. I want to close with this. Wesley had a prayer in his covenant. Every year he got with his pastors. And he did a covenant service. And y'all, these allergies are just killing me. At least it's not long and strange. Let me read for you what Wesley has said in his covenant. And I tell you, some of y'all are going to really blanch at this. Because I know where you are on which side of the spectrum. I'm submitting to you that it's both and today. Wesley said it was both and. Listen to this prayer. He says, I am not my own. I am yours alone. Make me into what you will. Rank me with those you will. Put me to use for you. Put me to suffering for you. Let me be employed for you. Let me be laid aside for you. Let me be lifted high for you. Let me be brought low for you. Let me be full or let me be empty. Let me have all things or let me have nothing. With a willing heart, I freely give everything to your pleasure and disposal. Jesus said, come. Believe. Receive. And out of your innermost being will flow rivers of living water. This morning, our prayer team's going to be available to you to pray for you. Maybe you've never saturated yourself in the Holy Spirit of God. Maybe you need to come this morning and receive the Holy Spirit in power and his authority and yield to him every part of your being. Maybe you need special prayer for healing, something in your body, something in your mind, something is not right. Maybe you just need to come and kneel here at this altar. Maybe you need to give your life to Jesus. You've never trusted him. You've never come to him. You've never believed in him and trusted him as your Savior. You can do that this morning. He wants to change us. He wants us to be different when we leave here in just a few minutes. let him baptize you in his spirit and make it different. I pray that you do. Father, hear our prayer this morning as we look to you and look to you alone to do that which you do, Lord. You do all that wonderful supernatural work. Lord, you do everything that will cause us to be conformed into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, give us this morning a holy dissatisfaction. And Father, may we crucify the flesh and all of the unholy dissatisfaction. Lord, give us wisdom to live these days when we navigate opposites in tension, when we struggle between discontent and contentedness. Lord, when we find ourselves saying, what I have is just not enough, when in actuality, who you are is more than enough. God, I pray that this would happen for the glory of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask it in his name. Amen and amen. You come as the praise team leads us. We will trust God for the results. Thank you.
services this morning, welcome. There are gift bags over here to my right, and so you should receive one already. If not, I apologize, and I'll just get you. I need to get busy. And so, also, unless you're on the first row or the last row, there are cards in the chairs in front of you, the back of the seat, and they're maroon cards. And so, if you're new, please fill those out so we can contact you. On the flip side, a prayer request. And our prayer team meets faithfully every week to pray over the needs that are written on those cards. So we're very proud of that. So according to your bulletins, we got a new Sunday school class. And so they started today. It's taught by Judy and Herb Parks. And the topic is Shame, the Thief of Intimacy. And so we got this class in 1:15. Then we have a class in David's room. We have a class in the conference room. And then the youth, they also have Bible study every morning. So praise God. So we got those classes going on. They all start at 9 a.m. and they go to about 10. Disciple Makers, the final session of this year, Disciple Makers, will begin on Wednesday of the 24th. So for $3, you're going to have a hearty meal of soup and salad and sandwiches by the best soup makers in the Brazos Valley. And we'll eat in fellowship from 5 to 6, and at 6 o'clock p.m., the lessons will start. Now, also, the youth are also meeting, okay, on Wednesday. And so they will be meeting in the youth room. They'll also have food, fellowship, and faith. And it will be led by Joseph and Debbie Chandler. Our All Church Luncheon, Heritage Sunday, is coming up on February the 4th at noon. So there is a sign-up sheet out front. So please sign up for what you're going to bring. Pastor like his banana pudding, and as long as it's done, I'll eat it. I don't care. But anyway, so there's a sign-up sheet out front. So please sign up. Also, Sisters in Christ, we're having our first Saturday event on February the 24th. So that's outside. Judy Parks is going to be speaking. So please sign up for that if you're going to be attending. Okay? And we also need you to bring a covered breakfast dish for that. And then last, but certainly not least, a Nest fundraiser. And so save the date. So they're having a mystery theater dinner, dying for chocolate, on February the 17th at 6 o'clock p.m. So please contact Joseph Chaplin if you want to attend. They are selling tickets, and it is a fundraiser for our NEST program. Yes, they have it up there. Okay, good. Okay. I think that's about it, if I hadn't forgotten anything.
Today, I encourage you to be a blessing to Sam and root for the Buffalo Bills.
Yeah. Oh, no.
Thank you.
last but certainly not least, if you notice, our prayer team is still standing. And so they are so faithful. I'm so proud of these men and women of God. So if you want prayer after the service, please go over and they'll be willing to pray for you. So I have nothing else, without further ado, let us all stand, please, for the benediction. Father God, we thank you, Lord, for the word and for the worship. We thank you, Lord, for the message, Father God. So, Lord God, I pray, Lord, that God, that they would remember, that we would cling to, that we would hold on unto the words of Christ, Father. If we accept Lord Jesus as our Lord and Savior, Father, and if we accept the gift of the Holy Spirit, Lord, that we will never thirst again. So for those, Lord, that go through the week being thirsty, help us to remember, Lord, that Christ is the answer. Lord, give us the gift of remembrance on this day. So blessings to your people, Father. I speak blessings in their coming and their going, Father. I thank you for what you've done for us already. I thank you, Lord, for what you're going to do. So blessings and joy and peace upon these, your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord. Amen.
What he's done.